Folks, welcome inside the Parisi Palace, high above 3773 East Broadway. This is a live edition of the Jake Feinberg Show, coming on Power Talk. Please go to our website, powertalk.live. Download our free app to your smartphone so you can stream all of our live local programming, including Solomon on Blast, the Jim Parisi Show, and yours truly, the Jake Feinberg Show. We can't thank you enough for making us part of your day today, and I've done thousands of interviews on the radio, and it's been cathartic for me to connect with my peer group over the last few years, because primarily I was interviewing cats that were from a different generation, and that gave me a foundation and musical knowledge to be able to joust with them on the radio. But being able to connect with my peers, and especially not just, I mean, it's one thing to connect with your peers, but then it's one thing to actually connect with people that you recognize have the same value set, or, you know, sort of follow the Joseph Campbell mentality of the insecure way is the secure way. And the most important thing is they're just really good people, and they bring a great vibe to the musical construct, which, as I've learned over time, as my ears have grown, the music is great, but the vibe is probably almost equally as important. And my next guest is has been parts of you know, has had a really interesting musical career, and he's part of this legendary, iconic psychedelic rock folk group called Beachwood Sparks that kind of flew over my head because I was just in a different phase of my life. But people, some of the headiest music cats that I know absolutely were obsessed with this band. And I've been able to talk to a lot of the guys that were in this group, and get a chance today to talk to a guy who's really carving his own path. And on top of the music, his current area of interest in psychological work is the use of mindfulness and present moment experiential interventions. Be here now. Chris Gunst, welcome to the Jake Feinberg Show.
Thanks for having me. Pleasure to be with you.
It's been a long time coming, man. You know, we have a game on this program called Name That Voice. I don't expect you to get the voice, but I want you to pay attention to the content, and then we'll come back and break it down.
Okay. But what happened to me, I had a similar experience to Ram Dass. When Maharaji could read his mind and tell his future. I mean, I can't explain this. I'm a scientist, so I can't explain as a scientist what I observed.
Mm-hmm.
I got to the ashram, Kenshi, in North India. I got there because my wife had extorted from me, practiced the ancient art of extortion on me, and said, I will leave you unless you come to visit Neem Karoli Baba. And I had to choose between being with my wife, who I've now been married to for 47 years, and again, they say hippie relationships don't last, 47 years. And because I loved her and I didn't want to leave her or hurt, more to the point, her to leave me, I went with her to India, and I went to the ashram, and I had read Ram Dass's book, Be Here Now, and I met Ram Dass. And I was intrigued. But my first few days there were terrible. Everybody was bowing down to idols. I hated it.
Right.
It didn't go well with my Judeo-Christian belief. I mean, I know what the Ten Commandments say, thou shalt not have before me any other god. And I didn't like this. And then I didn't like the fact that everybody was touching this guy's foot. I mean, bending down and putting their hand on his foot. These were the two things that I didn't like. The third thing I didn't like was that he ignored me. I mean, I did think that I would get to the ashram. I mean, we had to come from San Francisco. I had to pay off all my debts, my medical school debts. Finally got there. I did expect I would go there, and the guru would say, "Well, welcome, grasshopper. I've been waiting for you." Not only was there no grasshopper and welcome,
right?
Nobody said anything to me. I felt like the odd man out.
Wow.
And it was so nice to my wife. It felt like she was in a cult, and I wasn't very happy. So after about a week of increasingly feeling like this scene was not my scene, I told Gerija, my wife, that I was feeling not well, and I took the day off, and I went around a lake, a kind of Himalayan glacial lake that was in the area, and I was trying to find something beautiful to put into my head to dispel my increasingly dark depression, because I realized if that was not for me, I would lose my wife. And so, you know, I would go and I would take a boat out into the middle of this awful lake that was filled with green algae. It was a eutrophic lake. It was a dying lake. The British had thrown all their junk in it, and now the Indians were paying the piper for that. But still, I kept on rowing. I'd go up to the bank, and I would see a little flower. And as if I could have put that flower into my head or into my heart, it would have made me feel better, but I couldn't do that. And I would just go and I'd look at the temples that were there, and I would try to find some peace. And I would repeat my mantra. I would try to say something, a prayer in Hebrew or Sanskrit or Tibetan or Hindi or English, every kind of like the greatest hits, you know, the Lord's Prayer and Om Mani Pani Hung and Om Ram Shri Ram or Shema Yisrael. I mean, you know, I could kind of just rattle them off. I didn't know what they meant. But for the first time in my life, I became so distraught, I started to pray. I wasn't even sure how to do that. You send a letter to God, you don't know what the proper salutation is.
Mm-hmm.
And I was trying so hard to be honest and express this terrible feeling I had that I was going to lose my wife. And literally, you know, how do you call the deprogrammers to get her out of a cult? Or if he would give me a small sign that this was the right place for her and for me, I would do anything. And, you know, I looked up in the sky and I said, it doesn't have to be a big rainbow in the sky, Lord. Give me a little tiny rainbow and an oil slick. I'm the only one that needs, you know, or just make me feel something. Or Ramakrishna famously saw two white egrets flying over the sky, which put him into samadhi, into ecstasy. I'll take one. And it can be a dark egret. I don't care. Anything, a bird, nothing. But I had no sign.
Right.
And, I was more depressed than ever. And then I came home that night, I said, Gerija, this is not working for me. I'm going to leave. And she said, I know. And we cried and we hugged. And that night was just a terribly hard and tender and loving time together. And the next morning we got up and we packed our little orange backpacks. We divided our meager possessions, and then I got ready to go. And she said, "Well, you are going to say goodbye to him, aren't you?" And I said, "You know, I mean, we're from the Midwest. Of course, you go to say goodbye. Our parents taught us." So I said, "Of course, no. I mean, I don't like this place, but I'm not without manners." So we got a taxi, and it took us down to the ashram. And as luck would have it, we were the first ones there. Of course, I don't believe it was luck. And as luck would have it, we sat down at the tabletop, or it's called a tucket. Little Miss Muffet sat on her tucket. It's mm-hmm. a little like a bench that he would sit on. And we waited, and I happened to notice that the villagers had brought flowers and fruit and sweets, and they had arrayed them on his tucket, on his bench, to make the letters of the name of God. And in Sanskrit or Hindi, that name is Ram, one of those names of Ram. And there were apples at the corners. The letters are so beautiful. It's called the mandala. So beautiful to have all these fruits and flowers and sweets arrayed to spell the name of God. And whether you believe in God or don't believe in God, like Ram, don't like Ram, have a different God you like, still, it's a treasure when people do that, and they're going to gamble. It's such a sweet thing that they had done. And as we kind of sat down and jostled ourselves, one of the apples rolled off the tucket, landed on the ground. And in my monotheistic Jewish way, I noticed that the name of God was incomplete. And they teach you in Hebrew school that the name of God is sacred and it can never be incomplete. The letters cannot be incomplete. So I kind of reflexively reached down to pick up the apple, intending to lift it back up and complete the name of God. And the moment I put my hand down and grabbed the apple, the doors burst open, the guru Neem Krodo Baba leaped out and jumped onto my hand.
No.
And pinned my hand to the ground with his foot.
Oh, my God.
And I was then not only a captive, it felt like he weighed hundreds of pounds. I couldn't. I mean, I was bigger and stronger and younger, but I couldn't extricate my hand.
Wow.
And I was touching his foot, exactly the thing that I had said offended me the most about being in India, is touching a feet. And he's got me pinned down there, and he looked at me, and it looked like he was 100 feet tall, and I looked like an insect. And he didn't say grasshopper, but he could have. He looked down at me and said, "You weren't here yesterday." And I had this kind of mixed feeling. I mean, on the one hand, I didn't like my foot touching, my hand touching. So on the other, I was glad he missed me, you know.
Right, right. He acknowledged it for the first time. Yeah, right.
You know, I thought like, and then he looked at me and said, "Where were you?" And he began to interrogate me. And all the time laughing, he said, "Ah, did you go horseback riding? Ah, did you go, you know, snowshoeing?" I mean, you know, things that you could never have done. And I'm thinking, he's putting me on. And then he looked at me, and his face just seemed to be filled with love. And his eyes filled with compassion. And he said, "Were you at the lake?" And when he said that, I got a buzz in the back of my spinal cord. And then he said, "Were you talking to God?" And then I got these tingles. And then he said, "Did you ask for a sign?" And that was it. I don't remember what happened next. I went into this state of consciousness that I'm sure was something like my older spiritual brother, so much more advanced than me, who I love and adore, my teacher Ramdas talked about. When Maharaji made all of the electrical circuits in his brain go so fast, his rational mind couldn't keep up with it. But for me, I had one more rational thought before I slipped into this state of consciousness. For a second, I looked up at him, and it seemed to me as he loved everybody in the world without distinction, every race, every religion, every caste, every gender, everything. He just loved everybody in the world. And I had this one thought, well, that's okay. He should love everybody in the world. He's a guru. And if he were a rabbi or a priest or a minister or an imam, their job description is to love everybody in the world. So he's just doing his job. And then I had this fleeting thought, but in this moment, I love everybody in the world. And I didn't know that this body, this machine, came equipped with the capacity to love everybody in the world. That was my last thought. And then I went and drifted into another state. And he started, you know, playing with my beard. And all the other people in the ashram came around and hugged me. And Girija hugged me. And it gradually, as I came out of this state, I gradually realized that this was my initiation.
Well, first of all, I want to apologize. You had to sit through a 10-minute story there, but,
it was great.
I'm going to send you the interview because this is Dr. Larry Brilliant, and I didn't finish the story because of my anxiety, but the point is that he came out of this consciousness state, Maharaji looked at him and he said, "Dr. America." And what Dr. Larry Brilliant has done at that point, he went and he was in India. He went and cured smallpox in India. And I mean, this is, and so I'm going to send you this interview. It was, and you know, Wavy.
I don't know who that is. He sounds so interesting. Sounds great.
Well, and I guess, Chris, I just, without knowing you, I do understand that, like, so much of your soul and your life force revolves around, for lack of a better word, I'm just taking it off of what you studied, is Buddhist psychology. And I don't expect you to have a Ram Dass or a Larry Brilliant story, but is there something similar that you can at least riff on that relates to sort of the spiritualism and the mysticism of life? Because I just feel like in all sorts of commercial advertising today, in so much of our society, everything quote unquote is known. Right. Is known. Everything's known. You should know everything.
Yeah.
Everything's, and it's not like that. And people go through growth spurts and at different times. And I, like I said, in my career, I found my voice through a myriad of things. And I kind of wanted you to just, you know, you've been patient enough to sit through that story. And I wanted you to just riff on it any way you wanted.
You know, no, I'd love that story. And the reason I love that story is because it's like this moment of surrender for this guy. You know, like, and I think that's the kind of story that really rings true, is kind of like a, almost kind of a journey for most people, you know, in life, this kind of rich, wonderful moment where he said it so beautifully when he said, "I didn't know this machine could love like that."
Yeah, exactly.
And that's kind of, that kind of gives me the endless smile to hear, 'cause you know, when you have that experience, you know, of something so much larger than our kind of daily consciousness, you know, and you're in kind of trapped in this push towards, like, even when he was talking about it, you know, like, I don't touch feet, and like, And what I learned as a child about spirituality and God doesn't mix with what I'm seeing here. And just when that all gets broken down because of just love in general, you know, and that's what starts to become the true thing. You know, it's just, I don't know. I love stories like that.
Is there a way for you, I mean, to talk about, personalize it in your own, I mean, you went on a trip where you're now, I mean, it's just, I was kind of just doing some background research on you, and this career that you are, I mean, setting aside the artistic and the music, I mean, you are in this thing, go back to the quote here, it says, helping people in the present moment, right. Be here. I mean, it was like a be here now thing. I'm like, boom, I'm going to hit him with that Larry Brilliant story. So I mean,
beautiful. Yeah. So yeah, I mean, so you know, I think, you know, post kind of music world, I think a lot of the music that used to come from me was this kind of like you know, seeking and looking and trying, is there something greater than myself, or, you know, and I was suffering a lot back then, you know, and I was a young guy, I was fairly anxious, you know, and kind of you know, the way I kind of understand it now is, you know, I was sort of bracing against the world. Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
You know,
absolutely.
Bracing myself against the world and kind of afraid of things, you know, and wanting to, you know, I think have, you know, that kind of manifests itself as wanting to make sure I'm good so that others will think I'm good or something like that. And then, you know, I don't know. So over time, you know, looking for some kind of healing for that, you know, I was kind of inspired by Buddhist teachings. And then when I found the school that I went to, they had an emphasis on the master's degree program for Buddhist psychology. And I was like, oh, this sounds great. But a lot of it was kind of just like, you know, this kind of seeking mind behavior, just like, I want to know, like, is this it, you know, is this all there is? And so, you know, and I think a lot of people are drawn to those kinds of spiritual pursuits because of the recognition of their own suffering, right? You gotta walk through that in order to truly have the energy and the drive to actually do the work that's needed. So, I don't know, when I first started hearing, you know, the psychology of Buddhism was taught through the Tibetans. You know, they were kind of in charge of this, and they're very academic, you know, and so there's lots of lists and lots of things that you learn at first, and I remember the first time I had a class like that, and then we came back, and it was all about the potential of the mind, and even hearing that kind of stuff, I was like, I don't know what they're talking about, and like, but I felt so odd, like my mind was relaxing, but like that kind of monkey mind sort of scenario was freaking out, you know, the kind of
that
egoic structure is just like that I was basing my being from was like, what's going on? And so I just, something that reminds me of this story was the teacher the next day was like, oh, did anyone have any interesting dreams last night? You know, I was like, what a strange question to ask. And then they said, well, it's just because once you start hearing the truth of the Buddha, you know, sometimes things happen to you. And I was just like, I just felt like I was in the right place, you know, and kind of opening up to that the mystical truth, you know.
You know, I mean, there is, I mean, I was raised, I think part of it was like, I was raised agnostic. So and it was not like a conscious thing, but it was like, you know, the idea of organized religion was just sort of, you know, it was belittled to a degree, and that's all well and good. I mean, I have a very Jewish name, but my mom is Catholic. So, you know, and being able to connect with Krishna Das and Chris Gunst and Dr. Larry Brilliant, all these are mere, this is like, this is the beginnings of like essentially accessing my multidimensional self. And it's been like a completely cathartic thing. And I'm doing it on the radio and in some cases, obviously, you know, on Facebook Live. But I mean, authentically in your practice now, was there a moment or a time when you had to face this sort of fear of the unknown, and was the music something that helped you, your anxiety? Did it help you find your voice?
You know, over time, I there's kind of like this, there's this one guy I really like named John Eisman. He's a therapist up in Eugene, Oregon. He has this thing called recreation of the self where, you know, he's taken a lot of these, he's older. So he was around the time that this guy must have been around. He was doing a lot of spiritual work right back then. And
wow, I got to check this cat out, man. Like, this is badass. I got to check this cat out, yeah.
Yeah, John Eisman, he's awesome. But he has this thing, recreation of the self, where he talks about, you know, how when we're born into this world, we have this kind of organic movement, this, you know, which really speaks true to like Buddha nature or our essential self or whatever you want to call it. It doesn't really matter what it's called. It's kind of like, that's why it doesn't matter what religion, they're all kind of the welcome mat pointing into the same room, right? But if you, you know, part of the thing is when we get squished and we have to kind of, you know, squash ourselves to survive our families or to survive our wherever we're born or the culture or whatever it is, you know, we still get messages from this essential self, you know, this kind of spirit in exile, if you will, you know, the kind of the part of us that's pushing us to open. You know, I think the music for me, as I look back on it, was that part, you know, because some of the words when I hear in some of the songs, they sound like messages to myself now, almost. And I'm not sure, some of the times I didn't know why I was saying those things back then. You know, and so I think the music inspired me such to bring that part of me out, you know, and in to my awareness. And so, because a lot of the songs I wrote back then have kind of like a hopeful nature or looking to finding some kind of happiness or looking up from the bottom or that kind of feeling or an expansive feeling, you know. So I do feel, when I hear it now, like I kind of feel like that's kind of what was happening, that that part of me that was wanting to come out was kind of, that's where it could do it.
Is there, just for point of reference, is there any tune that comes to mind or jumps to your mind, or a lyric that, that you could point to that speaks to that light?
You know, there's a song that I have, that Beachwood has called Let It Run, and there's a part in it that's kind of like, talks about aging and getting old, and like when you grow up, don't forget, you know, when all you had to do was look up and look around.
Absolutely.
There's this kind of, yeah, and you know, that's that kind of freedom that comes with these sort of realizations in mindfulness practice or any kind of spiritual practice, is this surrendering, right? This like looking up, this like, you know, allowing yourself to be a part of nature again.
No, I mean, it's like, well, and also just sort of shot into me there, the idea of like facing mortality, or dealing with, getting older,
yeah,
you know, and that fear of death. And I mean, it's kind of, I see it on my journeys because, with the cats that I am, you know, interviewing, a lot of them are, you know, they've been around for 8 decades and, you know, some of them are, you know, completely at peace, and some of them,
are gripping, right? Some, well, might be gripping.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's just like, I mean, it's people that have been sort of taken from this sort of place of like, you know, being a problem solver, solution, logical diversity kind of thing. And then all of a sudden through health issues, they are like on bed rest. And so anxiety is like enveloped them. And then there's just other people that are, you know, maybe, I guess the other question is this. I mean, what it comes down to is, when you were on the bandstand, when did you understand that you are merely a conduit for the music? I say this because there's a lot of cats that older, you know, studio session guys, and you know, they were prolific doing jingles, commercials, toothpaste, sessions all day, every day, you know, back in the day of the industry, quote unquote. And then the phone stops ringing at a certain point, and they become very bitter and resentful, even though they have all these gold records and they have all this legacy. And they're bitter because they actually, their ego suggested to them that they were fully responsible for the music that they created or helped create. And I'd love you to talk about when you really understood, if you did, that when you were really just, as I am on the radio, just a conduit for that music.
You know, I think it was fairly young when a lot of that was first starting. And I think at the beginning I wasn't quite sure. Like in some of my first bands with just like friends in college and stuff like that, a lot of it was, you know, we'd get in a room and sort of play, and we were vibing together. So it just was like there wasn't a lot of talking about it, or so it was kind of. Right then I kind of like, wow, if I, you know, let myself kind of be creative on this instrument with these people, like something gets built that's bigger than me.
Wow.
You know,
wow, that's great.
And I never really, and then when I got more into Beachwood and met those guys, and, you know, I think, you know, they would use the word writing songs and things like that. And that was a little bit foreign to me. You know, I was like, I don't know if I can write songs. I don't know what that means. And like, I felt a little pressured at first, you know, like I have to have this fully formed idea. But then, you know, I kind of just did the same thing where I would have a small idea or something that would come just from noodling around on the guitar and bring it to the guys. And then we make it our own, you know, it becomes something more with other people. So I think I had that vibe from the get go. And then, I think it might have been Chris Robinson, like when we went on tour at the Black Crows, you know, he talked in those terms of like of the muse or this or the kind of endless song that's playing just out of reach of every human being or something like that. And I had this I do remember talking to him about that, like, and I liked, I didn't have words for it at the time, but he sort of, you know, had those words, and it kind of really rang true to me. And it, and I still to this day have that feeling where, you know, these kind of, whatever instrument you're having, this kind of music comes to you, and then a feeling comes to you, and then you try and put that stuff into words or something. And then when I went to school, I studied some Carl Jung and stuff like that, and you start to learn about, you know, archetypes and the, you know, collective unconscious and all this stuff and all this psyche soup that's floating around us all the time and in dreams and in yeah. how we get messages and stuff like that. So, it all sort of kind of comes together now that I'm a little older, you know. It kind of, it's like, oh, that's what was going on.
Talking to Chris Gunst here on the Jake Feinberg Show, having a ball. You know, I mean, this idea of searching for, Chris was talking about kind of searching for this sound that you're constantly in pursuit of, and that, you know, it's sort of just a little bit out of reach, but that's kind of the tantalizing and a part of music. Is that kind of what he was getting at?
You know, I think it's more that it's not out of reach, that it's there when you open yourself up to it.
When you get out of your own way.
Exactly. Yeah. And so you stop kind of questioning, like, oh, are these words the right ones? Or, like, what does this mean for other people? Or, you know, what is it, what record does this sound like, or whatever it might be. You know, at some point you're just like, well, you know, this is what's coming to me now, so it must have some meaning. It must have some meaning for something, or you know, the great whatever archetype or story or truth that's coming through your own individualized filter, you know, is just kind of coming out right now, and that's, I think, what other people try to, you know, can relate to.
You know, this is important. You know, I just would, you could talk, relate it to yourself, but also the cats in Beachwood, or, you know, just sort of the, or just, you know, your general musical community.
Sure.
You know, were you somebody who just, outside of, you know, maybe getting some tutorial, some lessons, private lessons or things like that. I mean, can you talk about your evolution were you self-taught as a musician? I mean, I guess the point is that you guys, when I think of Farmer Dave and Dan and Neely and those guys, I mean, none of you guys came out of the academy. Okay. None of you guys came out of like Berklee School.
Right.
I could be wrong about that, but I just wanted,
you're right.
The self-taught component of music, to me, lends itself to complete authenticity, and those are the cats that I'm driven to. Whether, it doesn't matter what genre of music it is, and
sure,
what are the what are your tenets, and what is your what would you say to cats out there that, you know, are being told that the only way to get into music to a career is by going to school in order to get a career, when in fact the issue that I have now, especially in jazz, is like, cats are going to the academy and then they come out sounding just like their teacher. So we have this homogenization.
Yeah.
We have this homogenization of sound. And, you know, and so, you know,
yeah,
I want.
Jazz did do that, didn't it? It got all like congealed or something.
It's become almost classicalized. Like, you don't really hear the.
Yeah.
And a lot of that's because sometimes cats in academia don't want to play with the guys on the street that are playing with rubber bands on their horns. The enclave that I found with you guys are into that. I mean, you want to merge that. And I wanted you to just talk about the, you know, this is the other question on top of that, is the idea of saying, were you more interested in liking the sound? Some people are obsessed with facility and chops, but they don't focus on liking the sound that's coming out of their apparatus. I mean, were you focused first on liking that sound before really developing a lot of chops?
Yeah, you know, that definitely. I think, you know, I did in high school, I took like a class at the city gym. I grew up in Huntington Beach, California, and there's a you know, me and a buddy went to, you know, this little city gym, and there were some dudes in there, and they taught, you know, how to tune the guitar, you know, the chords with some finger charts or whatever. And then, yeah, after that, I just kind of tried to learn songs from, like, music I liked, or I had an uncle, my Uncle Joe, he would come over for Christmas and, you know, whatever, and he played guitar, and, you know, he'd play Beatles songs or something on my acoustic guitar, and I was just watching his fingers touch the frets and in the right moment to make this, like, chord was just like, whoa, that was beautiful to me. It was so cool, and I wanted to do that. And so just practicing and having friends that, you know, would teach you something here or there. But once I got into college, I met some friends that we wanted to make a band with, and we were into a lot of indie music and even, like, some, like, hardcore music and stuff. And so, yeah, wanting to, the kind of inspiration of those times were to create something that was your own and your own sort of sound. So I think it was, you know, everything's kind of inspired by other things, but yeah, I definitely wasn't a virtuoso on the guitar.
No, I mean, I think more to the point, like, whatever scene that was, indie scene, that was the kind of thing. Yeah. If somebody came up to you and said, hey, man, you sounded great. You sounded just like so-and-so. You wanted to, like, slit your wrists? Like, you really just wanted to? Because those are the cats, most of the cats that I talked to, all the drummers, especially from the, I don't care if it was Gregorico from Sly Stone or David Garibaldi or Michael Shreve or all the cats. I mean, if somebody came up to them and said you sounded just like, they'd be depressed for a week. Was that the kind of vibe? Like, I mean, and then was it in that indie scene in Huntington Beach? I mean, was it something that was taken as a point of pride?
You know, I don't think so. At the time, I don't think so. You know, I think I was so young that if someone said, like, well, that sounded just like this, I'd be like, oh, cool, you know? Like,
right. Yeah, I dig.
I was just like, somebody likes me, you know? Like, I was, like I said, like, I was searching for approval. You know, I would have probably eaten that up. But I think, you know, I just didn't know. Like, over when I met Brent Rademacher, they asked me to play bass in their band Further, like, and they were talking about chords, like, oh, this one starts in A, and I'd be like, oh shit, like, what's that, you know, like, I'd have to, because I learned the guitar just, like, almost with numbers, or just, you know, because I was and then I played, and then once, you know, I started learning about songwriting and things like that through those guys too. You know, and when I met Dave, he was similar. Like, he'd come over to my dorm room. We went to college together, and he'd have, like, a little 4-track recording of a whole song, you know, and I was just like, wow, man, that's so cool that you can do that. Like, I didn't think in those terms. I was like, oh, you got to have a bunch of your friends together, and then you make something come about. So it's kind of, for me, it was the blending of those two that really led into Beachwood.
Right. I mean, this is, I mean, so, yeah. So that, I mean, cause I think it works both ways. It's a merging of the two, but you,
yeah.
Would you say that you brought the sort of, I don't want to say folk aesthetic, but you brought that idea of being with people playing together, and creating something that wasn't there before? To those cats, like Farmer Dave, is
you know, not consciously, you know, not on purpose, I don't think, you know, I think that, you know, I think we were all such good buddies that we still are. I'm not mean to be past tense, but at the time, you know, we're such good friends that when we get into the room and to play some music, pick up the instruments, and there's a little riff or something or idea, you know, no, everybody is just like joining in together. You know, we're making that togetherness without, just because we all like each other so much, you know?
Well, and I had to just, you know, I mean, it's so great. It's so, no, I mean, of course, yeah. I mean, you're feeding off that, it's what I talked about at the beginning. I mean, the music, if it soars, that's incredible, but it's going to be even more palatable when everybody is grooving. And, you know, that doesn't necessarily mean, you know, smiling. It just means just everybody's playing, listening, and everybody's playing off of each other.
Yeah, and I used to be like something that used to really make me feel good about in playing music was like knowing that we're all feeling it at the same that like oh wow he's so into it too, you know, like that.
I mean, it's. So I mean, let me ask you though, like this is really interesting. What when Farmer Dave came over, what did you learn and relax about as it related to the songwriting process? Because you clearly collaborated and began to become a songwriter. So how does that process work for Chris Gunst?
The process of writing music, you mean?
Writing a song getting in a room and feel and playing, you know, but actually crafting something.
Yeah, hey, how about this little part?
Right.
And then I think, you know, I just start getting more used to the structures and stuff like that. And then, back then, I probably, you know, hear a song or hear a vibe from a particular record or something like that or other music and just be like, wow, like there's something in me in that, you know, and then like what is my kind of version of that, you know, or something like that. And then I'd fiddle around and see what came up, and if it brought up the same feeling, maybe I'd try and flesh it out a little bit more. But I think what I learned from like Brent and Dave, because they were kind of confident with these songs, like, hey, here's this song I wrote and it was finished, was just like the path or the the permission to do it, you know, like, well, what would it be like if I tried that, you know, like maybe I'll try that,
right,
and
right,
put it out there, you know. And when we started Beachwood Sparks with me and Brent and Dave, you know, that was really new for me. And so, like, luckily I had those guys, because I'd be like, okay, here's this song, you know, and then they'd be like, oh, that's good, you know. But I always like to switch it up once they start to try. But, you know, it was up to me to write the words or the melody or something. And so, you know, it was really grateful that they were, they go, okay, that's your idea. We'll play along and make it something all together. And, you know, that just feels really good when you have that camaraderie and that feedback, you know, because we could trust each other enough to be like, that's really good, but. I was really young, you know.
In your 20s or something, or younger than that?
I mean, Beachwood Sparks started like when I was a senior in college.
Really? You were wet behind the ears, man.
Oh yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Did you find like at least early on, I mean, in the studio? Well, I mean, it goes both ways, but I mean, a lot of times now with the technology, people will just spend 40 minutes making sure a kick drum sounds perfect, and they'll do 40 takes of a song. I mean, I feel like my gut tells me, without knowing this, like Rademacher and Farmer, Gunst, like I feel like you guys come from that school of the first take is always the best. Is that true?
Yeah, you're exactly right.
I'm feeling it, dude. I'm feeling it. I mean, explain the
security. Well, because I met Brent too, we were all like in Los Angeles, and like he was in this band Further that was, you know, popular there, and they were playing like indie music, like indie sensibility, like with, more modern sounding guitars, but had like a, you know, almost like a California vibe to it, like with, you know, Byrdsian sort of ideas and all sorts of stuff mixed together. And everyone was playing at these small clubs with no sound system. You know, we were playing in these little places called like Jabberjaw and stuff. It was like a little, you know, with just a sound system for the singing. You know, so we kind of grew up, you know, cut our teeth in that kind of world, not playing in clubs, but playing in these little places. Even when you went on tour, you'd play in like living rooms and stuff. And so we got used to knowing how to make the band sound good in those kinds of scenarios. And so, when you go to a place and the guy's like thump, 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 you know, and you're just like, oh my God, what is the point of this?
Cause exactly.
Yeah, because when people come in, it all changes anyway, and we were always kind of, you know, concerned about that because our band was dynamic. Beachwood was dynamic. We'd have quiet and loud and medium ranges and energies coming up and down, and that's why it was always kind of a hard thing for us live in those times, because the sound people would, you know, it's really hard to do that when you set the levels up before you even start to play.
Dude, and I'll tell you that, you're nailing this, because yeah. You go and see some places and that turn the dial up to 10, and that's the biggest issue with modern music. There's no dynamics, and it never changes from 10.
You know Jonathan Richmond, you know that guy?
I do, yeah.
Modern Lovers, and we played a show with him in Spain, Beachwood did, and that's what he taught. He used to say, he's like, oh, when I go in the club, I just tell him to turn off all the subwoofers or whatever. And, you know, he's
exactly.
Like,
exactly.
And he said something. He's like, the sound men are just trying to impress their girlfriends, is what he told us. You know, and we're just like, oh, man. And so, yeah, towards the end, we started to get people that could run our sound for us that knew what they were, knew us, and we felt good with. And people we met along the way, so that was more helpful. But even now, we don't play very often, but that's still a problem that plagues us to this day. We're so excited to play, and we're like, ah, crud, we gotta deal with this again, you know.
Well, I'm just curious, because it was such an insane trip for me to come. I saw you guys at Fernwood.
Yeah, it's like playing in that upstairs bar. That was good for us. That's like, all right, there's no, you know, no big sound thing, and we're just gonna play that. Like, that's the best for us, I think.
I think it's fantastic. I mean, the idea of did you come in with the dynamic concept? I think that, because I think your name, that's, you had a quote somewhere in an article, you said, I think people nowadays are less accepting of new sounds, so bringing back an old sound becomes new. It's pretty profound. Uh-huh. It's pretty profound, actually. I mean, can you talk about, even though you were talking about further using more modern...
Uh-huh, sure.
Talk about bringing back an old sound becoming new.
Yeah, because, you know, I don't know, you know, like we're talking about with, like, psychology and this kind of, like, unconscious minds and things like that, where you don't know where that, why or what these things are coming to you for. Like when at first you're liking a Universal Order of Armageddon album, you know, and then you're like, oh wow, the birds are really awesome, you know, like so, but what's speaking to you in that moment? I think the sound is sort of timeless, right? So, you know, back then when we were first starting, you know, Beachwood Sparks, we wanted to be, you know, we were hoping to be more simple and more, you know, let's write these kind of heartfelt songs and almost with this kind of countryish vibe. You know, it's because we were, you know, we were all really, you know, we bonded over kind of the pain of life, or this kind of like idea, like, you know, where we're all kind of anxious dudes, and I think one, you know, searching for things and feeling scared at times, and, you know, and when you relate on that level, you know, I think whatever sound comes out of you, whether it's inspired some past or the present, it does make it new. And I don't know what I was trying to get at there. But I think
you're nailing it. You're nailing it, dude. You're being your. It's called being yourself, because I mean, you're the whole society, and you probably deal with this in psychology practices.
Yeah,
is this bent towards conformism? I mean, it doesn't matter if it's music. Yeah. You have to conform to some kind of compartmental thing that's going to be palatable for. I'm talking about pop music, but yet you guys are basically saying I'm feeling these vibrations, and there's some push and pull, because I'm doing what I really feel inside, and what I feel inside is not conformist, you know?
Yes, exactly. And back too, when we were, you know, all through our initial career of putting out records, not the later ones, but the first three, you know, we don't have a lot of peers, you know, at that point. You know, we're playing, we're on Sub Pop, you know, we're playing indie shows, which we were all good for because that's where we were coming from. But just like, you know, a crew of people that are, you know, we'd meet just like one or two guys that were like in their, we were in our 20s and they'd be like in their 40s being like, oh, I love David Crosby. And we'd be like, oh, cool. You know, we do too. But, you know, it's like, so now when I go to a show, you know, or Beachwood plays, like, you know, 15 years later, you know, it's cool like that. It's all really kind of spread. But it's also weird for us too, because it's like, oh wow, every, you know, like we're playing with a band. I'm like, oh cool, that band sounds like the Eagles, or this band sounds like Incredible String Band or something. But back then it wasn't, we didn't have that. So we were fairly unique in our little scene, I think. But
you guys are still like completely unique. I mean, I think that everybody borrows and steals and, you know, and then they,
sure, yeah.
But yeah, I mean, well, you just, again, we're just operating on this same frequency, Gunst and I are, and I want to put in another name, that voice. I think you're going to get this one, but it speaks to exactly what we've been riffing about. So let's take a listen to it and we'll come back.
Not just the blood of what we love and care about and want to bring through us, but the fact that these life choices, you can say it ain't easy or it's easy, but there's a cost, man, when you make a decision and stand by it on what you want to do and what you want to sound like. It isn't even, like you said, it isn't about how it's received or not received or if you get a lot of bread or not. It's still a very, it's a strong existential stand. You really feel that, you know? And hopefully, that's, you know, the music where other guys did that for us is what paved the way. And I think that's a certain kind of a lineage thing that's outside of academia, in the sense that you can't say where the next prodigy is going to come from or how. But I would say that whoever sticks their neck out there and knows how hard it can be but does their best, they're pushing us all forward in a certain way. And it's great, man. It's good to know that there's a sounding board and a like a radio show where everyone gets to listen and think about, you know, what their part in the story is. You know, someone who's a music fan is turning on like a love light. You know, have you ever been over to somebody with a good record collection's house and you put that on, you're not in that room anymore.
No way.
You know, it's a mystery school out in the open, which I think is why you might be a little bit, oh man, like we don't want all this homogenous stuff or there's gallons of music where it doesn't have any guts in it, man. But I think that I say yes more, you know, as much music and expression as our species can get going, a celebratory mood. And yeah, man, consider the scientific implications of raising the vibration. And the fact that, you know, objects are malleable in a certain way to form and thought and energy. So we really are, we're not just playing so that, you know, after a long work week, we can forget our troubles and kick up the heels. We're actually putting in and paying forward, like you say, man, future generations. And the fact that your body and your immune system will be different if it's at a higher frequency, if we're in alignment with the movement of the stars and the heavenly bodies, if we were not so busy with our life that we'd walk past a river without stopping and just flowing on it. You know, I think that getting our flow on right now is huge.
It's huge, man. You know, I mean, I could literally, I could hang with you guys. I would just love to, I mean, it's right in the pocket of that, of course. Well, you know who that was.
Yeah, one of my best buds.
I mean, that was my first interview with Farmer Dave from July of 2018, and the first part of it got cut off, and I just want to read it to you. He said, I'll tell you, man, I think he's talking about Beachwood, and he goes, we've had tough conversations. He said, we're always laughing, always making the best music we can, but the point is, there's blood in it. not just the blood of what we love and care about and want to bring through us, but the fact is that these life choices have costs to them. When you make a decision and stand by it on what you want to do, what you want to sound like, and it isn't about how it's received or not received, or if you get a lot of bread. It's just still a strong existential stance, and you really feel that. And I just wanted to ask you, you know, after hearing that, I mean, you're still making music, but you're not a full-time musician. And I just wanted you to, I wanted to know how that whole process, because I sure wish you were still a full-time musician.
Yeah, you know, the pursuits change, you know, and things of and my interests, you know, move on and expand, and you know, I have a family and things like that. So I do, you know, I definitely, you know, am seeking to make more music. I do write music and keep it. It's kind of just, you know, I just have ideas and little recordings and stuff, but. You know, I think that's something that's making itself evident, or is going to manifest in the next year or so, pretty soon. You know, we always still talk about, you know, recording and stuff, even though we don't do stuff a lot. Me and the Beachwood guys, we every time we get together, that's what we talk about. Hey, when do you think we should try and play again or do this? And you know, just the timing takes longer because we're not like living next door to each other anymore.
No, you're not. But, no, I didn't tell you this coming in, but I mean, like, it's my. I wish I had a deep well of resources, because I all I want to do is get Beachwood back on, even if it was a 2-week tour or something. I just I mean, do you feel like, because what Farmer, I didn't we let that quote run, but he's talking about these vibrations that, you know, that you know, your immune system's going to be affected by it, and you're going to be healthier because of it. And I feel it, man, because I mean, now I go to shows, I don't care if it's Circles Around the Sun or, you know, some like Facebook Live interview I'm doing with, you know, whoever it is, you know, it's like, I have not, knock on wood. I don't know how, I just haven't gotten sick because it's the vibrations. I mean, he's right.
Yeah.
He's right. And so do you still feel in your capacity now in sort of, you know, be here now in this, like, do you still feel vibrationally high, or is that something that you really only can do in a musical construct with cats that you really get off on?
Yeah. You know, there's definitely, you know, there's definitely an aspect dadding around, you know, being a dad for the first time these last 4 years. And, you know, that, so, I mean, although something's missing, something's also great. Another piece has grown super large, you know. So it's like, it's just getting high on different parts, you know, in loving and accepting what is there for me to be high from. And so, you know, music is something that I definitely want in my life and love and want to do, you know, and the timing feels really good to me right now. It's, you know, it's kind of cool to talk to you about it because it's inspirational. And, you know, I've been reaching out to different people around town to maybe play a little bit. And my wife and I play music together, and now we have a little place where we can set up our recording stuff and start to try and do it again. So.
Oh, that is great. I just would like you to continue. If the muse is telling you that, I mean, again, you know, everyone, there are consequences. I think what you're pointing out is interesting, just from my own point of view, after 13 years of marriage and sort of essentially diving off into this this sea of enlightenment and being and sort of recognizing that I'm doing something singular, that I'm doing something inspirational, that I'm trying to inspire people to be themselves. I mean, you know, like you said, you get high on being a father
but my
domestic life, I mean, you know, my wife and I, we divorced, and that's okay. It's we It was liberating because it wasn't healthy after 13 years. So I mean, I totally understand the idea of, like, again, you know, bringing in steady money, and you know, the music scene is not, it's the far, especially when you're doing indie stuff, it's the farthest thing from a reliable income source. You know?
Yeah.
You know, and so it's just like the balance. Like, I feel like Chris Gunst is just, you're in that point where you're like, how many balls do I want to juggle? How many can I juggle? How can I do it so that I'm really feeding all of my multidimensional self?
Yeah, and taking, but, and I think parts of that is recognizing and not having this kind of like, you know, if I need to have, you know, when the circumstances arrive, you know, and the right causes, you know, the right causes arrive for me to really delve deep again, you know, that's when I'll take advantage, or I'll let the conditions, you know, create that. And so I'm not so like pushing so hard, and it's just like the ideas are just different for me now. It's like I want to play live music, you know, and so I'm going to try and get some people together just to play country music covers or something, you know.
I lied. This is absolutely like essential. This is unbelievable.
Yeah, and like have like a little night at the home or at the house, like a couple times a month, where friends just come over and we play, you know, country songs or something. And then I have my own weird music that comes out that I want to record, and I'm just getting in the space to do that now. So it's all, the timing seems to be working out pretty good, you know. And I think also sometimes with music and my mind can get really taken up by things, and so, you know, wanting to create a nice trusting intimacy with the family life, you know, sometimes you give a little to get that safe, intimate, loving bubble in the family. You know, sometimes you give a little, and that's okay with me.
I mean, it's a, you know, listen, the point, if you truly, my wife was Taiwanese, you know, we struggled with, you know, I never really learned Mandarin. She spoke pretty good English, but I think that, you know, if you just truly enjoy spending time with that other person, if you truly enjoy it, then you're meant, then that's what it's about. You could be sitting in a room together, you know, if you have the same ideals on parenting, that's going to be very good too. But I mean, the idea is that just in general, if you can go and enjoy and not have any expectations, you could just be sitting there and relaxing together.
Well, yeah, that's, but your, she, you know, my wife plays music and we have instruments all around the house. And so music isn't absent from our lives or anything like that. You know, like, and my daughter, you know, she's playing, banging on the, being in a group, but like with Stone College kids, you know, it's like.
Well, you know, you cut out there. What is she? She's banging on a conga drum, or what is she banging on?
She plays anything that's out. So we have a little Wurlitzer she'll play with. You know, if sometimes I'll put the guitar in open tuning and she'll jam on that, and or if I play, we'll sing, or she dances. You know, like sometimes. Or my wife and I and her will all kind of try and sing and play together. And sometimes she'll like a song from like a Disney movie, so I'll learn it on the guitar and then she'll sing it. Like, she loves setting up the microphone with the amp with like some reverb on it.
This is, you know, it's true. It you know, my older daughter is playing piano, didgeridoo, and saxophone, because I mean, she's listening to, like, you know, why, I think that's the point, is also like your daughter's so blessed, because I mean, you know, you're filling her with so much independent, you're just, I mean, she's getting a full bag of music, you know. She's not getting inculcated with, you know, like you said, what do they call it, EDM music, you know, digital music, pulsating bass line, subwoofers, just what that cat was saying before about, you know, trying to impress your girls. It's just sometimes you know, and I mean I love
you know, I definitely love all music. You know, I love a lot of electronic music too. And so it's like, you know, yeah, but she'll get to hear all sorts of different things, that's for sure. And then recently at her school, you know, I've been teaching, you know, we have to volunteer a little bit at this little school she goes to. And so I did all this like volunteer teaching of singing, because they had a winter concert in so I accompany them on guitar and a couple different class groups and different age groups and learn songs that they wanted to sing. And, you know, I don't have professional per se singing training, but like I just, you know, mine is just like, well, just singing in your voice and it would all be good, you know. Like,
yeah, dude, concept. it's called having some guts on it, you know. There's some meat.
Yeah, let's do this. Yeah,
I don't need some, you know, perfect person that, you know, studied, you know, harmony or something. I mean, you're singing from your guts. That authenticity is going to come across to those kids, and that is absolutely and it's really cool, to be honest with you, to hear that you are percolating and coming up with some of your own material. And the house concert meant, I would just, you know, I think that is, I would just keep channeling that.
Totally.
You know, I think it's important. We could go forever, but I just wanted to ask you about your, I believe, a blood relative. How proud are you of Clay Finch right now?
Oh, man, I love Clay.
I do too, man. I love him. I love that kid. So he's just smiling. He looks at me, he's like, what's that?
I said, talk about beautiful singing. My God.
Yeah, that's the amazing singer. But I mean, because I asked him when I interviewed him, I said, how much was Chris helpful to kind of get you into that whole scene? And he didn't say that you did a lot. So I just was, it was coming from a genuinely honest place, but I just think that, but I mean, how has he grown? And I mean, how close are you guys? I just think it's, blood is thicker than water, you know?
Yeah. You know, his mom and my mom, we share, my grandma and his grandpa are brother and sister.
Whoa.
Yeah, so we are, I guess, technically second cousins. My mom and his mom are first cousins, but I grew up with his mom. You know, I'm much older than Clay. You know, I think I was probably either getting ready to go to college or maybe even there when he was born. So I'd see him at some family parties, this little dude, you know.
Thank you for reminding me. That's what he said. He said it was the age difference. You nailed it. Yeah. You were just in a different portal.
Yeah, totally. And I would just be like, oh, there's the cute Clay, you know, there's a little kid, that's cute. You know, I'll see you guys later or something. And then, wasn't until, you know, later on, his mom and my mom were talking, and she was like, oh, Clay's really getting into music. And, you know, his mom, Cindy, I was the ring bearer at their wedding, you know, like as a little kid, and for Clay's parents. And so, like, you know, I think his mom, you know, knew that he wanted to get into music and knew that I'd been through that at that point in L.A. And I got his number from his mom and sent out a text. He was still in college, and she's like, hey, we're recording. I know you're kind of into this kind of thing, or, you know, if you come on down and check it out. But he didn't come down. I think he was maybe a little shy or something. And then, I saw him at a Beachwood show. He came to a couple of those, and so we started talking, and, you know, he was really into all the similar kind of music. And one of the things he said way back then was like, oh, man, if I could just play a folk yeah show like at Big Sur, that would be the best thing ever. And I told him, I was like, dude, that is more than doable.
I love it, dude. Wait, hold on a second. What was the recording that you wanted him to come to that he didn't go to?
The Tarnished Gold.
Tarnished Gold. Unbelievable. Wow.
Yeah. I was like, come on down and check it out, you know. But that was kind of one of my first salvos to him, like, let's try and have a little relationship. And then so we would talk, he'd send me music and YouTube videos of a college band that he was in that was playing. And, you know, he always had such a beautiful voice, and I just told him just to do, you know, go, you know, you got this and go. And then when he said he was moving to LA, that's when I was like, I remember having a phone call with Brent Rademacher saying, like, hey, my cousin's around. He's great. He plays all this awesome music. He's such a beautiful singer, and he loves all the kind of records you do and we do. And, you know, if you see him, you know, maybe there's there's something you can help them out with, because I think Brent had like a DJ night that had bands that could play at it, and so they met, and Brent did really step up like the brother he is to me, you know, and kind of like helped those guys out a lot at the beginning.
Well, I mean, Brent Rademacher is a mensch, and is somebody who is just like, I mean, a facilitator. I'm trying to find the quote here, but yeah, I mean, I was trying to figure out how he, because he kind of got Mapache, or at least discovered in some way. You tipped him off that he was down there, but eventually he got them going at a regular gig at some maybe place called the Lost Night or something. You know, it was something like that.
That's what I'm talking about. I was just like, my cousin's down there. He's great. You know, I think I might have sent Brent like a little video that I had that Clay had sent me, you know, and it was a song to a seagull, I think, that song that ended up on the Mapache band. It was like with a full band when Clay was in college, and it was killer. It was really good.
You know what I love? Well, there's a couple things. Number one, I think, I mean, you probably, through your talks, I kind of feel like in my talking to him, he had a similar kind of musical camaraderie the way you did it at what college? Did you, Cal State Huntington? Where did you go to?
No, I went to Loyola Marymount. That's where I met Dave and
you went to Loyola Marymount. Okay, so but the idea of going, like when you said you first started in music and going in and playing with people and realizing that something could be created, he was talking about going to Chico. And that kind of same vibe, where it was just kind of just playing with people, obviously having interest, but playing. And I mean, and the thing that stands out to me about Clay is that, I mean, especially in the Mapache thing is fascinating. They what I love about that group is that they are so, I don't know what the right word is, so ambivalent about adding any kind of rhythm section. They just like singing duo. You know, like I'm looking for like a sick rhythm, burning funk rhythm section. They're like, I don't really want, you know, they're like, I'm just kind of cool just doing which is really cool. But when they do the Grateful Shred, Clay picks and chooses. But, man, he is a great improviser too, man.
Yeah, he's a great all-around musician. And I love his singing voice is just so beautiful, and I'm so happy, you know, to hear that. And yeah, just knowing, I just love that we're related, you know. I just think that it's a cool story to me, you know, and definitely, you know, and a lot of my friends, and they really love him and hang out with him and help him out and stuff like that. And because it's kind of cool, we do feel that when I hang out with him, we have kind of a similar vibe. And you know, I don't know. It's just kind of different apples on the same tree.
but
this one's a little sad.
Before I let you go, I just want could you just what has Neil Casale meant to you as a human being and a friend, I mean, it was so cool because when I showed up for that gig at Fernwood for Beachwood, you know, Brent disappeared for a minute, and he went down to the I could be completely wrong about this, but I just wasn't expecting Neil to play. I think he went down to the campgrounds where Chris Robinson was playing, and the next thing you know, Neil's on the bandstand with you guys, like smiling ear to ear. And I'm like, these are the shamans of the 21st century, as far as I was concerned. And so how did he get into Beachwood? Because he wasn't in the original iteration. And then what has he meant to you as a friend?
You know, he was friends with, I think he was friends with someone that Brent knew. And we were going on tour, got that Black Crowes tour, because we met Chris in New York, and then we got a call to our booking agent, hey, do you want to open for them? And we're like, well, that'll be cool, you know. And then but we knew we were going to be playing bigger places, so we wanted an extra guitar because we were just a four piece, and Brent knew Neil somehow. I don't even really know how he did, and he came and like practiced a few times, and he just sounded great, and he was so sweet, you know. He just kind of was all, he was there. Like, one day he wasn't, the next day he was there.
That is incredible.
He just got along and no problems, you know what I mean? When, like, but I think something about that time, that's a, you know, that tour was had its hardships and was long, and it was, you know, 9/11 happened on the day we were supposed to play the Greek Theater in Los Angeles, you know, and just driving, being through the country all together, playing music for people right after this, like, crazy trauma, you know.
I just want to be clear. Was that the opening date of the tour? Was not the 9/11?
No. We had a couple before then. We were up in, like, Idaho and, you know.
This is on, and that's what I'm talking about, because there are cats that are, you know, maybe 7 years old, dear friends of mine that I've known from summer camp back in upstate New York, and I mean, they were obsessed with Beachwood, but it was the timing of it, that tour,
yeah,
with 9/11, that must have been pretty spiritual stuff.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, definitely, and all the songs we were playing were, because, like, Dave talks about the cost of things. I think in that band there is an emotional cost to playing together, and I talked about this with Neil not too long ago when we played the show in the desert. You know, with a lot of the songs that we would always bring to that were, you know, we were kind of mining our fears and our heartbreaks and our losses, you know, in that band as much as we were anything else, and that's why it was kind of cathartic for us. And Neil is part of that too, you know. He's a very sensitive man too, you know, and he fit right in with that kind of
freaking lie. This is
style.
I mean, dude, just get, I mean, I want you guys to run for political office or so. I mean, this is unbelievable. I mean, this is the greatest group of cats of all time. I mean, it really, I mean, so I just want to be clear. It was Spursky, Sure, Farmer Dave, Rademacher, you on bass, and then Neil wound up making it a quintet for that tour.
Yeah, no, I played guitar all through that time. Brent was on bass.
I'm sorry. So the bass was in Further. Bass was for the Further.
Yeah, I only played bass, and that's how I met those guys, because they needed someone to play bass, and I was like, oh, I think I can do that. But then, yeah, Aaron played drums. Dave did his thing. Brent was playing bass, and me and Neil played guitar, and Neil played a little piano too during that period. And ever since then, he's just in the band. You know what I mean? And sometimes he's around, and sometimes he can't be. But when he is, it's just like, you know, Neil's back, and, like, I don't know. I feel with any of those guys, and with Neil too. Like, whenever I see him, it's just that's we're together, and that's it. You know, we have this kind of brotherly relationship in that way. You know,
it's like no time has passed, no matter how much time has passed. You know,
I think it's just like all, you know, the, a lot of the same jokes and, like, inside stuff in impressions we do. And all that stuff comes out because we were just in the van for so long, you know, but we're highly emotionally invested in playing music together. You know, it was, you know, the only thing I can liken it to is it's like in group therapy or something. Like, it's like, okay, I'm going to show my full self to these people.
Oh, I love it's total group therapy. Well, that was oh my God, it's the greatest thing ever. I mean, I think, you guys,
we just didn't have the skills. We were doing that with each other, but, you know, we probably needed somebody to be like, you know, it could be hard at times because of that. Like, I think we trusted each other enough to show each other our some of our shadow sides, and, you know, it was, you know, just being a little too young to help out if someone needed it or something, you know. I don't know.
Well, no, I will say this is when I just interviewed Mason Williams on Facebook Live. You know, he wrote for the Smothers Brothers, and I mean, that's just the beginning of it. But what he said at the end was, he said that the two greatest people I've ever met in my life were Pete Seeger and Ken Kesey, and he said the reason is because of their outlook and their love of mankind, and then this is the key word, warts and all. Okay, so with all the imperfections, you're bearing your true self, and you feel completely vulnerable, and yet you feel completely safe. And
exactly.
That's it. That's what you're describing.
And that's what brings us back to the Dr. America for that moment.
Dr. America.
You know, he was seen in that light. You know, he was seen in that light, and that's what's healing. That's what healed him and sent him in that. All that torturous, like, is this right? Is this wrong? What do I have to do? But when that guy finally saw he saw all that seeking and all that, you know, rah, and he loved him anyway. And that's what was the, that's what's so healing and beautiful about it. You know, we get to do that as parents all the time.
Well, I got to go do it myself. But
yeah.
You know, what's really funny is I'll let you know that I'm going to be back up in and around your area, actually, the 8th through the 11th. I don't know if you're in town or not, but I would love to. We weren't able to get to
February?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, I'm around.
All right, so let's try to find a time. We'll do it face-to-face. We'll do a Facebook Live, and I'll get you playing some. I mean, even if you and your wife want to play together, I don't care. Whatever you want to do.
That'd be great, yeah. Okay, awesome. Yeah, just text me when it gets closer, and we'll figure out a day.
Yeah, great to hang with you, Chris. It was
Good talking to you, too. Yeah, it was really, really fun.
Yeah, man, we'll do more. It was have a ball, man, and love your family and cherish every moment.
Yeah, you too.
All right, dude.
My friend. I'll talk to you soon.
Later, okay. Dude. Yeah, bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Just another whistle stop here on the Jake Feinberg Show. Chris Gunst of Beachwood Sparks. We will do more. Back tomorrow with Don Letarski, and then on Saturday with Art Maddox. Fred Tackett tomorrow, too. Big day on the Jake Feinberg Show. It's always a big day. Until next time, peace.
Saber qué hacer sin